Welcome to International Finance. I'm Andy Kim, your Dr. Finance. Since last week, we've been going through Chapter 6 of Eun, Resnick, and Chulun's International Financial Management, which is about international parity relations. What is this about? This is about the force behind foreign exchange market. So last week, we talked about international interest rate parity, IRP, and this week we're going to spend some time about purchasing power parity, the driving force behind the foreign exchange rate. So may the force be with you. So most of the things discussed in Chapter 6 can be summarized in this diagram, and this will get really clear after having two video lectures of mine from now on. And since last time we talked about this interest rate parity, IRP relations, what was that about? Well, throughout this chapter, we are trying to understand the driving force behind the foreign exchange rate, spot exchange rate versus forward exchange rate. And remember, everything has to be in equilibrium in this whole economy, global economy, right? Equilibrium relation, we're talking about it. And then forward exchange rate, that is nothing but our expected spot exchange rate, expected value of spot exchange rate at 1 year from now or X period from now, okay? What drives that expectation from today's spot exchange rate to future spot exchange rate expectation or forward rate? Well, that's this one, right? And then it is pretty much driven by the interest rate parity relations, right? The interest rate differentials between these two countries involved, right? And then if you think about your economics 101, the macroeconomics part that you learned before, okay? You will remember something called Fisher equation, right? Fisher equation, Irving Fisher. We're going to talk about that guy a little later. But that was about inflation and real interest rate. Yes, something related to inflation and then something real, right? Instead of nominal. What we talk about over here, right, in this IRP was nominal interest rate. But we want to decompose this thing into what? Inflation component and then a real component, right? And then there will come the Fisher effects component in it. And then we're going to talk about this pie is like inflation rate. Okay, two different countries may have two different expected inflations, right? How does that drive this FX market? Okay, that's something we're going to talk about. And this is closely related to, something called purchasing power parity. And that is going to drive the inflation rate differentials, will drive the differentials or the expected change in FX rate. Expected change in FX rate. Change in FX rate is, we always denominate as small e. This is not natural log, okay? Don't get confused, right? So we're gonna analyze this expected change in foreign exchange rates, and that is connected to this purchasing power parity relations, and it's also connected to this interest rate differentials through something called international Fisher effects relations. And then all things considered, we're going to discuss further about how these FX rate changes gets affected by these, you know, different components, right? So the next slide, let me see, right. So we're gonna talk about this purchasing power parity over here, which is pretty much about inflation rate differentials, right? There gets in the Fisher equations. We're gonna review this part more in detail, so wait for that, okay? Now, purchasing power parity, what is this about? PPP, right? The way I remember it is through Big Mac Index, right? What you see over there is a yummy Big Mac. It turns out it's not a Big Mac over here. But in Economist, right? The magazine called Economist, they devised this thing called Big Mac Index. The idea is this. McDonald's is everywhere in the world, almost. Well, even North Korea, okay, at one point, there was a news that the North Korea may bring in McDonald's. Right? That was like a couple of years ago, they had this news. But except for North Korea, right? Pretty much all the countries have Big Mac. Let me bring you this news article over here in Washington Post. North Korea reportedly wants a McDonald's. That could be a pretty big deal. 2018, they said it, right? But the idea is almost everywhere in the world, they have McDonald's, and then the Big Mac is their flagship product. And you see, this is Sawatdeepap, is like, is that right? Thailand McDonald's, right? They also have it. So anywhere you go in the world, you see McDonald's, Big Mac is the flagship product, and they carry the same ingredient, almost the same. I mean, it should be the same everywhere. I was thinking about something called bulgogi burger or teriyaki burger in other countries like Japan or Korea. But here, Big Mac is standard, right? The same ingredient, same, we call it the same basket of goods, right? Same basket of goods. So shouldn't it command the same price? Shouldn't it be priced the same? As long as they carry the same amount of bread and meat and then vegetables, same thing, same price, law of one price should hold, shouldn't it? Ah, cool. So let's check it. That is the idea of Big Mac Index. As it turns out, it's not, okay? Different countries charge different prices if you convert those Big Mac price in the local currency into US dollars. They don't necessarily show, okay, the same US dollar denominated price. Kind of funny, they say. This was invented by this magazine, The Economist. By the way, I strongly suggest you to keep reading The Economist. I'm going to make some midterm exam questions or final exam questions from there. Why? Because this is the most influential and then most thorough magazine in terms of economics, economists, finance, as well as economics all around the world, right? So the insight is very deep over there. So learn from it. That's why. Anyway, they invented this index in 1986 as a lighthearted guide to where the currencies are at their correct level. It is based on the theory of purchasing power parity, PPP, the notion that in the long run, the exchange rates should move towards the rate that would equalize the prices of an identical basket of goods and services in any two countries, right? In any two countries, same basket of goods, same price, anywhere in the world. Okay, it should be like that according to purchasing power parity relations. So Big Mac price should be the same everywhere, but seems like it's not. And then some currencies seem to be overvalued or undervalued. You can figure out using this Big Mac index. So Big Mac index, here is how it works. One Big Mac, right? Same basket of goods and same price. Let's see. In March 2021, how much is it, Big Mac? In South Korea, 4,600 Korean won. And then in US, it is 5.58 US dollars. And then right now, if you look at investing.com, the actual FX rate today is 1129 Korean won per US dollar. So if you convert this 4600 Korean won into US dollars, that will be dividing this guy by 1129. That's only 4.074 US dollars. Ah! In New York or in the US, on average, you have to spend 5.6 US dollars to eat Big Mac. But in Korea, it costs you only $4. So it's cheaper over here. Implied purchasing power parity of US dollar based on this Big Mac price in Korea. Turns out, one US dollar should be about 824 Korean won per dollars. Right? That's very interesting. Korean won is accordingly undervalued against US dollar by about 27 percentage point right now. That is, how do you compute that? Well, the implied purchasing power parity of US dollar, 824, minus current FX rate, over current FX rate. Okay, so that gives me minus 27 percentage point, which is negative. That means it is, Korean won is undervalued. Okay, US dollar is overvalued, right? And then what does it tell us? Well, in the long run, okay, Korean won is going to be appreciating more, right? But not necessarily quickly, right? And then all these kind of things you can check out in your URL that I gave you, the Big Mac Index. They talk about this, right? You can play with this a lot more, okay? And if you click South Korea, where are you? Korea, yeah. And see Hong Kong, and then other countries, right? Saudi Arabia, you can identify where your country is located relative to US dollar. Undervalued, overvalued. Right now, dollar is very strong. So relatively, other countries are, more countries look undervalued. And then over time, here's a time series chart of it, right? And then Singapore, yeah, that's over here. And then you can find out Korea and then get some idea about where this Korean won is going, right? And another thing is, you may want to find out their Big Mac Index time series data. This is the age of big data. So GitHub has almost everything, right? Big Mac Index, right? You can download it in Excel format or CSV format. And then you can play with it. I may give you some exam questions based on, you know, this data. Go ahead and download this and then play with it. I can ask you, right? Over here, right? I downloaded it and it gives you periodic data. And if you go down, scroll down further into it, you can see that it comes from 2000, April, right? Where is Singapore? And then, yeah, South Korea, there we are, right? Like this. So you can see time series changes of overvaluation versus undervaluation of your currency and things like that. Anyway, so very interesting database you can play with. Anyway, so that's the way I understand about the purchasing power parity. Same goods, a basket of goods. It should command the same price, but why not? The key driver is inflation. Okay, inflation. Different countries have different inflation rates. So the exchange rate between two currencies should be equal to the ratio of the currency's price levels. Some countries command high price levels. Some countries have low price levels, right? Living expense and all these kind of things, right? Now, spot exchange rate between dollar and pound is nothing but, you know, price level of US dollars over price level of British pounds, right? So for example, if an ounce of gold cost $300 in the US and £150 British pounds in the UK, then the price of 1 pound in terms of dollars should be $2 per pound, right? Because it has to be, the spot exchange rate has to be nothing but the price level ratio between these two countries, right? The same goods has to have same price. Law of one price internationally, right? So that's why. Two, suppose the spot exchange rate, okay? I mean, this what you see on this left-hand side is Professor Gustav Kassel, I guess, right? Swedish economist who initially proposed this purchasing power parity idea. Now, suppose the spot exchange rate is $1.25 per euro if the inflation rate in the US is expected to be 3% in the next year and 5% in the eurozone, then the expected exchange rate in 1 year should be like this, okay? 1.25 times 1.03, right, should be equal to 1 euro times 1.05. So 1 euro should be, okay, you send this guy to the other side of the equation by dividing both sides by 1.05. So that's why you have this, okay? €1 stays here, and then the other guy is on the other side of the equation. So it gives you $1.2262 per euro relation, okay? That's next year's expected FX rate. Remember, you can compare this guy with current spot exchange rate, right? It's going down, right? Anyway, so the euro will trade at a 1.9% discount in the forward market. That's what you can infer from this. So forward exchange rate over spot exchange rate, it will look like 1.03 over 1.05, which is nothing but 1 plus inflation rate of dollars, and then 1 plus inflation rate of euro currency. And then we just use the pi as a convention over here to represent the inflation rate, okay? Relative PPP states that the rate of exchange, rate of change in exchange rate is equal to the differences in the rate of inflation, roughly 2%. Okay, why is it pi? Well, perhaps because it's purchasing power parity relations, right? Inflation has to do with price level. P, Greek letter, pi, that's why. Anyway, so that's that. PPP and IRP, it's all about the forward rates and spot rate relations. We are talking about the same thing, but PPP is interpreting it using inflation rate, like P pi is over here. Interest rate parity that we discussed before last week is using interest rates of two different countries, right? And it's all about F over S, forward rate over spot rate relation. They should be identical all the way down, okay? Notice that our two big equations equal each other, and this week's portion is this reddish part, orange part, okay? Last week we talked about this part, okay? We move on. All right, now, expected rate of change in exchange rate, which is labeled as this, as inflation differential. We see these mathematical relations, all right? We could also reformulate our equations as inflation or interest rate differentials. Remember, small e, the rate of change in the exchange rate, okay? Then that is this guy, right? Exchange rate, the change in FX rate in the future. That's forward rate minus spot rate over spot rate, and that's using this forward rate to spot rate relations based on PPP, price purchasing power parity, right? We start from this, okay? Minus one. Why is it minus one? Well, this guy, S over S, the same thing divided by, multiplying divided by the same number, that's one. So that's why we have one over here, minus one. And then if you bring this guy to up on the numerator, right? It will be like 1 plus pi of euro minus 1 minus pi of dollar, right? That's 1 because it is over 1 plus this denominator, pi of US dollar, inflation rate of US dollars. And you see, cancel each other out. And what is left is in your numerator is pi of euro minus pi of US dollars. And what you have in your denominator is the same thing. But if you assume inflation rate of US dollar is very small, okay, you can assume that this guy is nearly zero. So that's why we have approximate relation like this. Your small e will be close to this numerator, which is inflation rate in euro minus inflation rate in the US, right? Take expected value for both sides of the equation. What we have is expected value of the rate of change in exchange rate. should approximate the differences in expected inflation rate. Okay, this is called relative version of purchasing power parity. So in essence, this tells us that your expected FX rate change is nothing but the inflation rate differentials between these two countries. Clear? Good. So we're going to meet in the next video. So thanks for watching and then see you.